Good afternoon, students. Let's discuss the climax of the chapter, Events, Trials and O-Level, and also its textbook questions and extra questions.
Number 86, the middle of the page. I hope all of you have your books with you. You have your books?
Yes, ma'am.
So please keep your books in front of you. You should have your books by now. And everybody has to sit with the book only whenever we have a class. Okay, so if I'm reading out the last line again, it had not been events impersonating McCleary who had walked out. So the one who had gone out was not events, but McCleary, who himself was not McCleary. He was also an impersonator, an accomplice of events. And the person who had stayed in impersonating McCleary was events. The fish and chips were delicious. And after a gentle stroll round the centre of Chipping Norton, Evans decided to return to the hotel and have an early night. A smart new hat concealed the wreckage of his closely cropped hair, and he kept it on as he walked up to the reception desk of the Golden Lion. It would take a good while for his hair to regain its former glories, but what the hell did that matter? He was out again, wasn't he? So he had, crop take him some time to grow his hair again, to regain its former glories. But what the hell did that matter? It doesn't matter. It did not matter for him. Why? Because he was out. He was a free man now, and the hair would definitely grow in some time. A bit of bad luck that when Jackson had pinched his scissors. What do you mean by pinching of scissors? What do you mean by pinching of scissors? Yes? We've read it already.
Jackson had taken away.
Alam, you're very right. He had taken away his scissors. He had also taken away his nail file and everything. It was a kind of a bad luck for him, for it had meant a long and tricky operation with his only razor blade the previous night. So he was left with only his razor blade, and with the razor blade he had to cut his hair. So it was not a very nice haircut that he would afford. But then he was happy. Why was he happy? Because he was free. He was a free man. He was totally liberal. But what he had had his good luck too. Just if he had his share of bad luck, then he had ample good luck also. Just think, if Jackson had made him take his bobble hat off, what would have happened then? He had appealed, you know, he was a very intelligent kind of a fellow. He was very clever, and he had appeals to the he had made use of his emotional intelligence. He had made an appeal to the emotional aspect of Jackson, and he had asked him to let him have his bobble hat because it was a kind of a lucky charm for him. Okay, so that really had been a close call, because Jackson had initially ordered him to take that filthy hat off, and if he had had to do so, then he would not have managed to escape. Still, old Jackson wasn't such a bad fellow. So he was just thinking of Jackson, even though he was a very strict prison officer, but still he had an emotional side also, and it was only because of him that he was able to having the hat on his head was one of the most important parts of his plan of his escape. Okay, so one of the worst things, funny really, had been the beard. He had always been allergic to sticking plaster, and even now his chin was irritatingly sore and red. So he had put on artificial, he had plastered it, artificial beard, and he was allergic to such things, and it was irritating also, and his chin was becoming red. It was red. So just keep your books handy in front of you. The receptionist on page number 87, the first line. The receptionist wasn't the same girl who had booked him in, but the change was definitely for the better. As he collected his key, he gave her his best smile, told her he wouldn't be bothering with breakfast, ordered the Daily Express, and asked for an early morning call at 6:45 a.m. Tomorrow was going to be another busy day because he had to rush out, and so he said that I won't bother you with breakfast and all, with all the formalities, but I want to be woken up early at 6:45 a.m. Okay, he whistled softly to himself as he walked up the broad stairs. He had sort of liked the idea of being dressed up as a minister, dog collar and everything. Now he was in the dress of a priest. he was liking it, he was liking that idea. Yes, it had been a jolly good idea for McClary to wear two black fronts, two collars. Now, only McClary, the impersonator, who himself was not McClary, the original McClary, he had worn in two black fronts, two collars, but that top collar, it had kept on slipping off the back stud. And there had been that one panicky moment when McClary had only just got his hand up to his neck in time to stop the collar springing apart before Stephens. So Stephens was very much right there, and he was also peeping in after every minute or 2 minutes. So once a serious problem was about to come, but it didn't, and it was avoided. They had got that little problem worked out all right though. A pen stuck in the mouth whenever the evil eye had appeared at the peephole. Easy. But all that fiddling about under the blanket with the black front and the stud at the back of the collar. So he made all the changes, the change in dress and everything under that blanket. And every time he had to manage it very well, because after every one minute, Stephens was peering through that peephole. He was looking into through that peephole. That had been far more difficult than they had ever bargained for. Everything else had gone beautifully smoothly though. In the car he had found everything they had promised him: soap and water, clothes, the map. Yes, the map, of course. The Ordnance Survey map of Oxfordshire. He had got some good friends, some very clever friends. So he had a whole party of friends who had been his accomplices in crime and who had helped in his plan to escape from the Oxford prison. So they had got everything handy for him: soap, clothes, map and everything. He unlocked his bedroom door and closed it quietly behind him and then stood frozen to the spot. The moment he got inside that room of the Golden Lion Hotel, he stood frozen. Why? Like a man who has just caught a glimpse of the Gorgon, or a man who had just happened to have a devil in front of him. Sitting on the narrow bed was the very last man in the world that Evans had expected or wanted to see. बिल्कुल उसके सामने कौन बैठा था जो वो सोच भी नहीं सकता था कि होगा कोई. वो कौन था? It is not worth trying anything, said the governor. So the governor was there before him. Okay, so he says it is not worth trying anything now. As Evans' eyes darted desperately around the room. What do you mean by darting desperately?
Ma'am, moving quickly.
Yes,
move quickly.
Yes, moving quickly. He was looking for something, some kind of a relief, some kind of a solace, something that she could get hold of. But he said the governor told him it is not worth trying at all. I've got men all around the place. Well, there were only two really, but Evans didn't know that. ठीक है, उसने उसको बोला कि हाँ, ये सारे होटल को चारों तरफ से घेर लिया गया है, जैसे आपने मूवीज में भी सुना हुआ है. एक्चुअली कोई नहीं घेरा हुआ था. There were only two men with him, but how would Evans come to know about that? Okay, he let the words sink in. He let Evans get an idea of what was happening with him. Women too. Didn't you think the blonde girl in reception was rather sweet? So he had noticed that the girl who had booked in his appointment was not the same girl, but he didn't understand at that point of time. So that she was also a part of the governor's plan. Evans was visibly shaken. He had not expected this was the last thing that he could expect. It was such a foolproof plan. Everything, had been managed so well. He had escaped and everything was done so well. But now he was again to land himself into prison. He sat down slowly in the only chair the small room could offer, and he just held his head between his hands. For several minutes there was utter silence. He could not understand how the hell it had happened. Finally he spoke. It was that bloody correction slip, I suppose. Finally he could make out, and he said that maybe because I just had just forgotten to take that correction slip, and from the clues that were there you could decode the clues, and you could decode them, and you could manage to get over to the Golden Lion Hotel. Well, the governor failed to mask the deep satisfaction. He was so happy with himself that he had actually, oversmarted the prisoner. There are a few people who know a little German. He said, even I have read German in my junior school, and I could decode it, I could understand it. And he was so happy with himself. The governor was very happy with himself. Slowly, very slowly, Evans relaxed. He was beaten, and he knew it. He sat up at last and managed to smile ruefully. You know, it wasn't really a mistake. You see, we had not been able to fix up any hotel, but we could have worked that some other way. No, the really important thing was for the phone to ring just before the exam finished to get everyone out of the way for a couple of minutes. So we had to know exactly when the exam started, didn't we? So he's now sharing in all the details of his master plan, that that time was very crucial. You know, the 3 minutes before the exam and the time when the exam started, everything was very crucial. And he's telling the governor the details of his plan. And like a fool, I presented you with that little piece of information on a plate. He says, I was just, I feel myself as if I had been a fool, because I had given that information to you. I had actually served it to you as if serving some dish on a plate. Well, somebody did. So you see, sir, that correction slip killed two little birds with a single stone, didn't it? The name of the hotel for me, and then the exact time the exam started. So all those, index number, center, everything was a kind of a clue, was a kind of a hint for Evans. The governor nodded. It's a pretty common word. Good job, it is pretty common, sir. I'd never ever known where to come to, would I? Nice name though, Zum Goldenen Lauen. So it was written in German, but I could decode it that you would be heading directly towards Golden Lion Hotel. How did you know which Golden Lion it was? There's hundreds of them. वो कहता है ठीक है गोल्डन लायन तो आपने डिकोड कर लिया पर आपको ये कैसे पता चला कि यहाँ पे इतने सारे हैं अराउंड हंड्रेड्स ऑफ गोल्डन लायन होटल्स आर देयर हाउ डिड यू कम टू नो दैट आई वुड हैव बीन हेयर ओनली सेम एज यू इवंस इंडेक्स नंबर 313 सेंटर नंबर 271 रिमेंबर सो आई आस्क्ड यू दैट टाइम व्हेन वी रेड देम आई आस्क्ड यू टू अंडरलाइन बिकॉज दीज आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्लूज फॉर इवंस एंड दे हैड टर्नड आउट टू बी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्लूज फॉर द गवर्नर एज वेल सो ही सेड रिमेंबर सिक्स फिगर्स एंड इफ यू टेक एन ऑर्डिनेंस अंडरलाइन दिस सो हाउ डिड द गवर्नर कम टू नो that he had reached this particular hotel, Golden Lion Hotel, not any other Golden Lion Hotel, okay? So it says, if you take an ordnance survey map of Oxfordshire, you find that the six figure reference, this 313/271 lands you directly in the middle of Chipping Norton, and here you have this hotel, Golden Lion. Yeah, you're right. We had hoped you would run off to Newbury. We did. Well, that's something, I suppose. That question paper, Evans, could you really understand all the German? I could hardly. With the question paper, मैंने देखा आपका. Could you actually understand that much of German? मुझे तो कुछ समझ में नहीं आया उसको देख के. Okay? He says, of course I couldn't. I knew roughly what it was all about, but we just hoped it would throw a few spanners in the works. You know, sort of muddle everybody a bit. हमने क्या सोचा था मुझे तो कुछ समझ में नहीं आ रहा था जर्मन ओ लेवल तो मैंने सिर्फ अपने मेरे एस्केप प्लान का एक पार्ट था वी हैड जस्ट होप दैट दिस काइंड ऑफ अ क्वेश्चन पेपर इज गोइंग टू कंफ्यूज एवरीबडी इट वुड कंफ्यूज यू ऑल्सो इट वुड कंफ्यूज एवरीबडी इन द ऑक्सफर्ड प्रिजन एंड दैट इज वाई वी वॉन्टेड टू जस्ट मडल इट अप फॉर एवरी वन द गवर्नर स्टूड अप टेल मी वन थिंग बिफोर वी गो हाउ ऑन अर्थ डिड यू गेट ऑल दैट ब्लड टू पोर ओवर योर हेड ठीक है वो इतना खून कहाँ से आ गया जो हमें लगा दैट यू हैव बीन टेरेबली हिट इतना खून आया कहाँ से इवन सडनली लुक्ड अ लिटिल हैप्पियर क्लेवर सर वेरी क्लेवर दैट वाज हाउ टू गेट अ कपल ऑफ पिंट्स ऑफ ब्लड इनटू अ सेल व्हेन देयर इज नन देयर टू स्टार्ट ऑफ विद एंड व्हेन द इन्विजिलेटर शैल बी से गेट सर्च्ड बिफोर ही कम्स इन ठीक है जब इन्विजिलेटर की आप पूरी थरली सर्चिंग करते हो फ्रिस्किंग करते हो तो हम कैसे लेके आते हैं उसको सो दैट वाज अ वेरी क्लेवर पार्ट ऑफ अ प्लान यस सर यू कैन वेल आस्क अबाउट दैट एंड आई डोंट नो इफ आई ऑट टू टेल यू मतलब पता नहीं मुझे आपको बताना चाहिए या नहीं बताना चाहिए हो सकता है मैंने बाद में भी कभी उसको इस चीज को यूज करना हो आफ्टर ऑल आई माइट वॉन्ट टू यूज दैट पर्टिकुलर फिर से मुझे अपने किसी प्लान में उसको यूज करना हो सो आई डोंट थिंक आई शुड टेल यू एनीथिंग टू डू विद अ लिटिल रबर रिंग फॉर पाइल्स परहैप्स सो गवर्नर कुड गेस इट आउट ही सेड कि कुछ वो जो रबर रिंग लेके आया था यू नो जस्ट द सेमी इन्फ्लेटेड रबर रिंग you know, which the impersonator, the fake McCleary had said that he had brought in because he was suffering from a medical condition, hemorrhoids, and he could not sit for a longer period of time. So he says Evans grinned feebly and he said, "Clever though, wasn't it? Must have been a tricky job sticking a couple of pins. No, you've got it wrong, sir. No problem about that. No, no, it's the clotting, you see. That's the big trouble. We got the blood easy enough. So this is their plan. The cleverest part of the plan," he says, getting the blood was not difficult. वो तो हमें बहुत आसानी से मिल गया. और कौन सा blood मिला था हमें? Pig's blood. It was from the slaughter's house in Kidlington. But to stop it clotting, you have got to mix actual blood. And he just took a breath and he said, with 1/10 of its own volume of 3.8% trisodium citrate. So he's a bit of, you know, he knows so much of chemistry also. He knows that in order to help the blood to coagulate, in order to help the blood to clot, you have to mix blood with 3.8% of trisodium citrate. Didn't know that, did you, sir? The governor shook his head in a token of reluctant admiration. He's admiring his prisoner. How clever he was. What knowledge he had about even the chemicals. And he says, we learn something new every day. So he is full of, he gives full credit to Evans. And he praises him also by saying that. And he says, we also learn something new every day. They tell me. So just come on now, my lad. Evans made no show of resistance, and side by side, the two men walked slowly down the stairs. He could not resist. He didn't show any signs of resistance because he knew it was of no use, because the governor had told him that he had got hundreds of his officers around the hotel. Tell me, Evans, how did you manage to plan all this business? You've had no visitors. I've seen to that. You have had no letters, ना कोई तुम्हारी written communication किसी के साथ हुई, ना तुम्हारे कोई visitors आए, ये इतना सब कुछ तुमने manage कैसे किया? He says, I've got lots of friends though. What's that supposed to mean? Me, German teacher? He says, did you ever think of the tutor who used to come to teach me German? You mean? But he was from the technical college, was he? Evans was almost enjoying it all now. Ever check up on him, sir? तो बोलते हैं, अच्छा वो टेक्निकल कॉलेज से सच्ची में था क्या? आपने कभी चेक किया, कभी कंफर्म किया दैट वाज दैट पर्सन एक्चुअली फ्रॉम द टेक्निकल कॉलेज? गॉड अलमाइटी, देयर इज फार मोर गोइंग ऑन देन आई हैड नॉट इमेजिन दिस मच, यू नो, दिस फार मोर टू इट देन आई हैड एक्चुअली देन आई हैड एवर इमेजिन और आई कुड एवर इमेजिन. ऑलवेज विल बी सर, एवरीथिंग रेडी, आस्क द गवर्नर एज दे स्टूड ऑन बाय द रिसेप्शन डेस्क. द वैन्स आउट the front, sir, said the pretty blonde receptionist. Evans just winked at her and she winked back at him. It almost made his day. A silent prison officer, underline this, the most important part of the climax. A silent prison officer handcuffed the recaptured Evans, and together the two men clambered awkwardly. What do you mean by clambering? What is this word, clamber? What is clambered?
Climbing sort of difficulty.
With sort of difficulty. Mohammed Uzair, mute karo. Haan ji, haan ji, Alam, you wanted to say something? Alam.
Yes, ma'am, the meaning only. Ma'am, to climb with difficulty.
To climb with difficulty. And very awkwardly, the two men climbed into the back seat of the prison van. See you soon, Evans. It was almost as if the governor was saying farewell to an old friend after a cocktail party. Cheero, sir. I was just wondering. I know your German's pretty good, sir. But do you know any more of these modern languages? Not very well. Why? Even settled himself comfortably on the back seat and he just grinned happily. Nothing really. I just happened to notice that you've got some O-level Italian classes also coming up next September. That's all. So he's full of humor. He's full of wit. And he says that you know German, but by any chance, do you know Italian? Because when I land up again in jail, I'm going to try and get my hand at O-level Italian. Do you know Italian? In a very humorous way, he ends up the conversation with the governor. Perhaps you won't be with us next September, Evans. James Roderick Evans appeared to ponder. He appears to think over the governor's words deeply. Underline, no, perhaps I won't. Why won't he be with them next September? The very next line gives you the answer. As the prison van turned right from Chipping Norton onto the Oxford Road, they hit her so silent. They hit, till then, the prisoner, the officer, the prison officer who had come and who had handcuffed Evans, who had recaptured him. Now, this person, he unlocked the handcuffs and he just bent forward towards the driver. And he says, for Christ's sake, get a move on. It won't take them long to find. They're going to find out very soon. So please hurry up, hurriedly move away from here. Where do you suggest we make for? Asked the driver in a broad Scots accent. What about Newbury? Suggested Evans. So the person, the driver who had come in, the silent prison officer who had come in, they are also the accomplices of Evans only. So this was a backup plan. He had thought that if by any chance, which actually had happened, the governor had come to know about his original plan and he had landed up at the Golden Lion Hotel before Evans, he had already had a backup plan ready for him, and this was a part of his backup plan, and he had escaped again. Okay, so this is all about this chapter. We shall discuss the questions. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. We shall discuss the questions and extra questions. And I think let's discuss the extra questions first. I've given you the extra questions. You have them, or should I just read them out?
Ma'am, you can read them out.
Yes, I'll read them out. Okay. What the first question says, you have to answer them in 30 to 40 words. What sort of a prisoner was Evans according to the governor of HM Prison, Oxford? What sort of a prisoner was Evans? We have discussed it. I want somebody else to answer now. Not the same students, not Alam or Malvika. Somebody else. Yes, Kushpreet. What sort of a prisoner was Evans? Bolo. Bolo, Kushpreet.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, according to the governor, Evans was a pleasant person, pleasant sort of person, and he had the congenital kleptomaniac, and he was caught several times and sent to jail, but he was so clever as he was arranged to escape from jail every time.
Yes, but he was a very pleasant sort of a chap, and he was not violent at all, and he was also very famous at the concerts, and he was good at imitating too. So what chance, next question says, what chance did Evans have of passing the German examination according to his teacher? Why? What chance did Evans have of passing the German examination according to his teacher, the German teacher who used to come in to teach him, and why? Yes. We have 47 students today, and every time I see the same students answering. Bolo. What was his chance of getting through, and according to his teacher, and why? Ronit, can you give the answer? Ronit Sen Gupta, can you reply? Ronit or okay, Alam, bolo bache.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, he thought that his German teacher thought that he had hardly any chance to pass the examination, as he couldn't even understand a simple expression of the that good luck expression before the exam day.
Yes, very good. So he said that you have a cat in a hell's chance to pass through, because he couldn't simply understand in German. He couldn't simply understand what best of luck. How it was said in German. So he said the German teacher felt that he had a very remote possibility of passing or of getting through. Okay. The next question says, Why had Evans' cell been bugged? Why has his cell been bugged? Again, the same two students, Pushpreet and Malvika. What about the others? Pavandeep?
Yes, ma'am.
Haan, bolo bache.
Ma'am, Evans' cell has been bugged because Evans had tried to escape from the prison several times, and the governor was sure that he was going to try to do it once again. And by listening in on Evans' conversation, he could hear anything that Evans did or said, meaning that it would be impossible for Evans to escape from the prison.
Yes, very good. Meant that he would have the cell bugged, he would listen to all the conversation that would happen between the invigilator and Evans. He would not try to make any plan to escape at all. What nagging doubt did the governor have, and what precaution had he taken to remove it? What was the nagging doubt that the governor had about Evans, and what precautions did he take to remove that doubt? Malvika.
Ma'am, there were many precautions were taken taken before the examination, and governor had a doubt that Evans will try to escape the jail once again while giving the examination. So several arrangements were done. All the nail files were taken from Evans, and moreover his room was also bugged to keep a check on the conversation. And Mr. Jackson and Stephens were put on the were personally checking if any of the fault is not conducted between the examination, and the conversation between the invigilator and examinee was also kept a check on.
So all the precautions were taken. He always had this nagging doubt that Evans would definitely try to, because he was famous. He was infamous for escaping from the prison, and that is why he had also been nicknamed Evans the Break. And so he knew it that he would definitely try once again. So he had to take no chances. So he took all the precautions. His scissors, the nail file, and everything was taken away from him. His bunk, his cell was thoroughly checked, and then bugging of the cell also. It was also done to ensure that he would not try to escape. How did Jackson check McCleary's suitcase, and what two things did he find objectionable in it? How did he check his suitcase, and what were the things that he found objectionable in McCleary's suitcase? Yes? Bolo, Shabash, raise your hands. After frisking Jackson, after frisking his clothes and all, he checked his suitcase too. And how did he do it, and what were the things that he found? There were two things that he found objectionable. Rhythm, can you answer? Kushpreet. Yes, Kushpreet, you raised your hand.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, Jackson checked the suitcase of McCleary very carefully. He picked the envelopes and turned them. He went through the pages of Holy Writ and shook the Church Times also. The thing which he find suspicious in the suitcase was the semi-inflated rubber ring, for which the excuse given by McCleary was that he could not, because of his disease, he could not sit properly without this.
Yes.
For so much time. And
yes,
the other thing was the paper knife, which
yes.
was kept by the Jackson with himself.
Yes, the other thing was the jackknife, which he took, and he said that you might not need it and I have to take it from you. He let him have that rubber ring, and later on we found out that what was there in that rubber ring. Good. Next is, what correction did Evans have to make in the question paper, and how significant was it? What was the correction that he had to make in the question paper, and how significant was it? Malvika, what was the correction?
Ma'am, the correction made in the paper was that from there was a correction that was golden in, he had to change into goldinini, and this helped him to this correction gave some clue to Evans which during the test, and governor was suspicious about this correction, but he could not do anything, and this helped as a clue for Evans.
Yes, it served as a great clue for Evans, and it was a part of his escape plan. Good. Next is what reason did Evans give for asking for a blanket, and what was the real reason? What was the reason that he gave? Why did he need a blanket? And what was the actual reason? Again, Malvik and Pushpi. Somebody else has to answer this time, please. I don't want these two students only to be answering. Yes, yes, Ritham, you can try. Good. Bolo bache.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, basically, even asked for the blanket. The real reason was something else, but he told Stephens that he was feeling cold, so he needed a blanket. And the real reason for asking for a blanket was to change into a Parsons dress to look exactly like McLeary.
Yes, very good. He, when he underneath it, he wanted to change the clothes. He wanted to put on the clothes just like McLeary in order to look like McLeary. But he gave the reason that it was very chilly and he was feeling a bit cold. So that is why he asked for a blanket. Why did Stephens shout wildly for Evans? Why? Let's try and find out. Yes, he shouted for Jackson. You need to change the question, because even I don't feel that there was any part in which he shouted for Evans. He shouted for Jackson, definitely. And that point was... So change the question. In which part did he shout for Jackson? Yes. Bolo. This is simple. Simple enough. Why did Stephens shout wildly for Jackson? Change the question. Why did he shout wildly for Jackson? Bolo. Very simple. Very simple question. Respond. Raise your hands. Alam.
Ma'am, he shouted wildly for Jackson, as it was suspected by them that Evans had hit McLeary and injured him severely, and had escaped the prison by impersonating him.
By impersonating McLeary, yes. So when he just came back before having the cup of coffee, when he came back to have a last look at Evans, and he saw Jackson lying, and he saw McLeary. McLeary, you will write within inverted commas only, because that person was neither Evans nor McLeary. So okay, he was also an impersonator. So at that point of time, he shouted for Jackson because he felt that McLeary had been hit terribly, okay, by Evans, and he had escaped again. Next, what special arrangements were required to be made for Evans' O-level German examination? You know it. You can answer this. Why does? Okay, Khushpreet, you can just reply. You wanted to. Yes, Khushpreet, you have raised your hand. What special arrangements were required to be made for O-level examination of Evans?
Yes, ma'am. There were many arrangements were made. Firstly, all the sharp things were taken from, like the scissors and razor were taken from the Evans, and. Then a special invigilator, which was a parson from a church, was also there, and Stephen also looked in the interval of 1 minute through the hole to check if Evans was there, and there was tight security arrangements so that he could not escape.
Yes.
While
security arrangements, there were topmost security arrangements that were made for Evans so that he might not try to escape. Next, last question of short answer questions is, why does Jackson ask Stephens to remove Evans' razor after he had shaved his beard? Why does he ask him to remove his razor? Very simple question. Why does Jackson ask Stephens to remove his razor? And I would add another part to it. What comment did he make about it? why does he ask Stephens to remove Evans' razor after he had shaved his beard? Bolo. Bolo, bolo, jaldi. A totally passive class that I'm you know teaching. Except for just three or four students, nobody is there to answer the questions. इतने दिन लगे हैं बेटा हमें ये चैप्टर खत्म करने में और जब क्वेश्चन आंसर्स में डिस्कस करती हूँ देयर इज हार्डली एनी रिस्पॉन्स. इट फील्स सो बैड. एवरी टाइम इट्स द सेम स्टूडेंट्स मालविका खुशी खुशप्रीत मालविका रिदम आलम and Abhay and Vishwajit, both of them are not here today, I think. Yes. What was the reason? Why did he ask Jackson, Stephens to take the razor away? Bolo? Anji, Malvika, bolo.
Ma'am, Jackson asked the Evans to take the razor away because he could hurt the invigilator who was Mrs. McCleary, and so he asked him to take the razor away before the examination.
Yes, because he felt that he could use it in order to by if with it he could even hurt the invigilator, and also he could use it otherwise also. And also there was a comment that he made. He said one day he felt that one day he would do himself good by slitting his throat with that razor. Okay, next is what role, long answer question, what role does McCleary play in Evans escape? So McCleary had a great hand in Evans. What was his role? He was a part of the master plan and a main part of it. What was his role? Yes. Yes, Khushpreet. What was his role in Evans' escape?
Ma'am, McCleary played a very significant role in Evans' escape. Actually, it was not the. It was not that. That person which was which would be as invigilator, he acted like the person only, and he was so confident and intelligent that nobody would suspect him. McCleary also sit like a person giving specific instruction like index number, center number, as he was the invigilator only. He also smartly answered the question about the rubber tube when Jackson suspected him.
Yes,
and he was only who gave instructions for how to escape, and he was the main
clothes?
Character in the
Very
plan.
Good. What about the clothes?
Yes, and clothes were also like then he pretended like McCleary, then pretended like he was Evans, and he stayed in the cell only, and they were.
And how he had managed to put in two collars, two black fronts, and you know all those things, the paraphernalia that he had brought in to help in the escape of Evans. Next question is, how do overconfidence and underestimation of the opposite side affect the functioning at the governor's office? Discuss with examples. There are two parts, two aspects of this question: overconfidence and underestimation. Of the opposite side affect the functioning at the governor's office. Who were overconfident and how did they underestimate? Who was overconfident? Yes. Two parts of this question: how do overconfidence and underestimation? The opposite side is we are talking about at the governor's office, the governor and Stephens and Jackson. So how were they overconfident and how did they underestimate the things? Yes, Alam, can you give the answer?
Ma'am,
Ma'am, first, the first underestimation and carelessness because of overconfidence that he would Evans would not escape the jail. They did not check his the room in which he was sitting carefully, and because of that, he was able to hide many things with him to execute his plans. And after that, there were certain circumstances even where they could have cached him when he was impersonating McLary. They could have been careful with him, but in all this carelessness of not recognizing the real events, and because of all this, he had been able to escape.
Yes, it was their overconfidence and they had underestimated things. They had never thought that, even at those, they committed so many blunders. You know, they did not check upon the teacher who was, whether he was a real teacher. It had started right from the beginning, who had been coming to teach him. You know, so all these things, and they were overconfident. They felt that with so much of arrangements that day, the day of the examination, so much of tight security, he could hardly think of escaping. So all these things made them commit so many blunders, and eventually Evans did manage to escape. The last question is, what is more responsible for Evans' escape? His smartness or the blunders of the prison staff? So you can write it either way. You can say that Evans was the one who was very smart and he oversmarted everybody, or you can say that it was basically the blunder, the blunders of the prison staff that made him escape. So yes, give reasons. What do you think? What is most responsible for his escape? The blunders that they committed or the smartness of Evans? Yes, yes, Alam, bolo.
Ma'am, according to me, it is more of smartness that benefited him, because even if the police makes many blunders, but the other prisoners are not able to escape, just because he was smart, he took the initiative to execute a plan, and that because of his cunning mind, he was able to escape. And rather than also, but the blunders made by the police and the various slip-ups from them just benefited him in his plans.
Yes.
So it was more of his cunning approach.
Yes.
Which
you feel that it was more of his cunning, clever approach, and the blunders committed by the prison staff, they were only an add-on, they just benefited him. But is there anyone who feels that the blunders of the prison staff, they are more responsible for his escape than his smartness? Yes, Khushpreet. You can give the answer. I told you can give the answer either way. Yes, Khushpreet. Follow it up.
Yes, ma'am. There were many blunders like committed by the prison staff. Firstly, Stephen was not responsible. It was not McLary that he. That they took him. That they left the cell and they took him with him. So, as McLary, Evans went with them in the car, and then he escaped from that car as he went to go for hospital. And also, they did not check their German teacher. They did not check on the departing man that so that there were no confusions. Evans blanked on the officer, made such a common mistake, he made a mistake, but officers were not able to find out. So we can say that it was the blunder of officer also which helped Evans escape.
For the blunders that they had committed, and towards the end also the way the silent prison officer, the governor, did not check upon him also, how he had come in, where from he had come in, and why he was so silent, he just let him, the governor could have easily accompanied him back when the prisoner was such, when he had outsmarted them so many times, he should have actually accompanied Evans back to the prison, but he just let a silent prison officer take him away. So right from the beginning towards the end, Evans was smarter, and they committed so many blunders to help him escape, and the governor actually proved to be a gullible, good for a giggle, gullible governor. Okay. Next is reflecting on the story, the questions that are there in your book. We have done these the assignment questions. Let's move on to the questions. The five questions are there. Reflecting on the story, what did you feel about Evans having the last laugh? You can easily answer it. It was Evans who had the last laugh, and how did he manage to do that? You would be able to do it. Would you be able to do it? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So it's just a repetition of whatever we have discussed today and in the other answers also. When Stephens comes back to the cell, he jumps to a conclusion, and the whole machinery blindly goes by the assumption without even checking the identity of the injured McCleary. Does this show how hasty conjectures can prevent from seeing the obvious? How is the criminal able to predict such negligence? जब स्टीफन्स वापस आता है और बोलता है कि मैक्लेरी हैज बीन इंजर्ड, इवांस हैड एस्केप्ड एंड हाउ टेरिबली ही हैड इंजर्ड मैक्लेरी, एवरीबॉडी अग्रीज टू इट एंड नोबडी इवन बॉदर्स टू चेक द रियल आइडेंटिटी ऑफ द पर्सन हु इज लाइंग इंजर्ड इन अ पूल ऑफ ब्लड. सो डज दिस मीन हाउ हेस्टी कंजेक्चर्स कैन प्रिवेंट वन फ्रॉम सीइंग द ऑब्वियस? जो हमें ऑब्वियस सामने दिख रहा होता है वो हम देख ही नहीं पाते इस वजह से. आपको क्या ये लगता है? डू यू थिंक Alam?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, because when Stephens came back to the cell and saw that McCleary was bleeding profusely, he raised an alarm. When he had earlier walked beside McCleary, when he was going with him to see him off, he noticed that there was kind of a change in his accent and his physique. And this was the plan of Evans, because of this, when he returned to the jail and he saw, he automatically thought that the one who escaped right now was Evans. And the change in accent just added fuel to the fire, And after that, when McCleary was events as impersonating as McCleary was bleeding profusely, they never and told them that he knew where Evans was. They never questioned him.
Yes.
They blindly followed
what that person said. They were worried about the blood that had been lost, and they did not bother even once to check on his identity, whether this person was actually McCleary or not. And the main blunder was committed by Stephens only when he overlooked the different the change, the variation in the accent, and also he ignored the physique that had changed. Yes, very good. Next,
ma'am, this also shows that the difference between the both of the approaches. Ma'am, like the criminal, he made a foolproof plan without any hasty assumptions. He but in contrast to him, the police, who should be smart like him, they were more gullible.
They were
and,
and they acted every time they acted in a haste, okay, and totally opposite to, totally in contrast to the criminal. Yes, very good. What could the governor have done? Yes, Gurnoor had asked me if he could leave. Yes, you can go. The meeting would take just 4 or 5 more minutes, but if you have a tuition, you can go. What could the governor have done to securely bring back Evans to prison when he caught him at the Golden Lion? Does that final act of foolishness really prove that he was just another good for a giggle, gullible governor? That was all. We've discussed it. You've just discussed it, that he could have, accompanied him, and because he had escaped so many times and he had outsmarted them so many times, and he just let him go with the silent prison officer. This also shows that he was, how casual he was towards his approach. He should have actually accompanied him. Okay. While we condemn the crime, we are sympathetic to the criminal. Is this the reason why prison staff often develop a soft corner for those in custody? We always condemn the crime, but we have a soft corner for the criminals also. For example, even in this story, Evans makes an emotional appeal. He directly attacks the emotions of Jackson even though he was a strict prison officer, and he requests him to let him have his hat on because that was a kind of a lucky charm. So this tendency, and even the governor, right from the beginning, he was sympathetic towards the criminal. There are many instances, there are many examples in the text that show that he was sympathetic towards him. He let him have that O-level examination. He requested the secretary of the examination board to give him a chance, and he also concealed information about him, that he was, he was known by the name Jailbreak. He had escaped from jail. So all these things show that even though we have a tendency to condemn the crime, but we are basically sympathetic towards the criminal. So and punishment, you can do it on your own. These five questions plus the extra question that I had given you, you have to complete them, and you have to send them to me on my personal number. Now, as far as, because you people are so much concerned about your test, let me just hurriedly take your attendance, and then we can talk about the test part. Okay, it will just take 2 minutes for the attendance. Okay, good. And that is all for today. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Koi doubts hai to pooch lo. Theek hai guys? So I'm going to end the meeting. Okay. That is all for today. Goodbye.